Good evening, everybody. I don't have my sign from the video. Welcome to the John F. Kennedy Jr. Forum. We're glad to have everybody here with us at the Harvard Kennedy School. My name is Trey Grayson. I'm the director of the Institute of Politics, and we're excited to have all of you here, and we're excited to have all these folks on the panel tonight. One of the things we're starting to do in the forum is we're going to have a series of forums over the next few years on innovation in government, innovation in elections, both here in America and abroad. And tonight, we're going to talk about the social impact economy and how businesses and other groups are innovating to meet the demands of the market and our country. So tonight, we're really glad to have David Wood with us. He's going to be our moderator. David's an adjunct lecturer here at the Harvard Kennedy School and directs the Initiative for Responsible Investing at the Hauser Institute, which is part of the Center for Public Leadership here at the Kennedy School. So please join me in welcoming David, and he'll introduce the rest of our panel. Thanks.
Thanks. Everybody can hear all right? It's coming back at me a little bit. Delighted to be here. I just live right down the hall at the end of the IOP hall, so it's like great to be part of an IOP event. And I'm looking forward to hearing what people who actually do things in the field of the social impact economy have to say. I'm one of the people who talks about it. And one of the things we all agree on is that there's a lot more talk than action. And so we're going to try to talk a little bit about the action. Starting from the end here, I'll just briefly introduce the panel and we'll dive in. Scott Griffith was chairman and CEO of Zipcar from 2003 to 2013, and he's now a private investor. And he can tell us about the world of enterprises and what the impact economy looks like from someone who needs money from conventional finance. Karen Mills is an IOP fellow, I'm delighted to say, and was the 23rd administrator of the Small Business Administration, serving in the Obama administration. While she was at SBA, the SBIC Impact Investing Initiative was started, and that was really just a flagship public policy that actually got some money out the door in this space, and we want to hear how that happened, and we want to have more of it happen. Dave Wilkinson is a White House Senior Policy Advisor for Social Finance and Innovation, working with the Office of Social Innovation and Civic Participation, as well as Environmental Quality, is that right? And before he just started, his first day was the day after the shutdown. Is that when you came in?
The week before the shutdown.
The week before the shutdown, you were there. So you just had a little blip as you started up. Before that, he was at City First Enterprises, very prominent in the world of community investment. And he went to UVA, and so did I. So there's that.
Wahoo.
No, we're not going to do the chants. And then right next to me, Tracy Palandjian is the CEO and co-founder of Social Finance US. And before that, she was at the Parthenon Group, managing director there, where I got to know her. I knew her back when, before she became a prominent voice in the social impact bond world. And she can tell us about all the complications of life with a totally new financial product that's meant to create social impact. So that's our panel. I'm just going to make 3 points, and then we'll dive into questions. The first point is that the social impact economy, we talked about whether we should define it, and we decided no, because it's as much a buzzword as a thing. We're really going to talk about people using financial tools and different kinds of enterprises to create social benefit in the context of financial return, and that's going to be many things to many people, and we have different perspectives on the panel that can speak to what that is. Secondly, there's this talk to action ratio that we're all concerned about, and we want to really focus on sort of concrete on the ground things that have happened rather than these definitional challenges for the field. And then finally, the panel represents different sectors. The social impact economy doesn't work unless government's engaged, unless the private sector's engaged, and unless the nonprofit and advocacy communities are engaged. And we can speak to all of those. We're also talking about different kinds of investments and impact investments. Some are focusing on social return and they use financial tools, but really are a way to create social outcomes. Some are market rate products that really fit into conventional portfolios, but have the additional or collateral benefits of specific social goals. And we can speak on this panel to these different pieces of the elephant. So, with that in mind, I thought I'd start off and ask each person, starting with Tracy and just going down, what piece of the elephant of social impact do you touch in your daily life, and what does the field look like to you?
Yeah, thanks very much, David. It's great to be back on campus and to be with old pals all the way back to Scott Griffith, back in the Parthenon days.
Another
we barely
Parthenon
overlapped. Exactly.
We're bookending the panel today.
Exactly. The part of the elephant that we tried to eat is really from the impact investing angle, and lots of you are familiar with the impact investing movement. It's basically built on the premise that our social challenges are large and intractable, and that the traditional sources of funding and addressing those problems, namely philanthropy and government funding, are simply insufficient to meet the demands of society. And it is upon that premise that an innovation called the social impact bond, it isn't quite a traditional bond, and we can kind of get into that nuance later if people feel like digging into that. But it's a new form of public-private partnership that brings together several unusual parties in an arrangement to drive financial value and social value such that the two are inextricably linked and actually quite different from other impact investments forged to date. If you think about the larger movement surrounding public equities, if you will, you know, ESG investing, investing with environmental, social, and governance screens, or the traditional SRI investing, which is really more about negative screens, you know, we don't do the bad stuff like tobacco, where the linkages between social return and investment returns are somewhat of a derivative value, less direct. What's exciting to some folks, and we're still at the very nascent stages of sorting out this new financing instrument, is that direct linkage. And when David first sent me this, you know, social impact economy as the IOP's theme, I was like, you know, there's so many definitions. So I looked it up, and it said, the impact economy, this is the Aspen Institute definition, refers to a market ecosystem that rejects the notion that the goals of financial success and social success are at odds. Rather, they complement, propel, and deeply inform each other. And as I tell you how the social impact bond works, and I'll do it very briefly because I think this is a crowd that understands the instrument, that direct linkage, that financial return is only derived by the betterment of lives. When the homeless are not going through the emergency room system, when ex-offenders are being rehabilitated into society, when children are deservedly getting into the right curriculum that suits their developmental needs, that's when social value is generated, and that's when investment returns are generated for the investor. So very quickly on how exactly this works, and the social impact bond, or the social impact partnership, as we call them these days, is working at an opportunity really at the intersection of our fiscal challenges and our social challenges. So it kind of brings the public sector into the dialogue, and it's very fitting to be at the Kennedy School of Government to be talking about this. And so it involves the government, private investors, and a set of providers in an arrangement that incentives are aligned and there's some kind of alpha, both socially and financially, that could be generated. And it typically starts with the following proposition, typically asked by state and local governments. In rare cases, we've been working also at the federal level. It starts with this, you know, either the mayor or the county leader or the governor asking the question, what social challenge am I trying to solve? What policy priority am I trying to address? Is it cutting recidivism? Is it improving health outcomes, et cetera? Then it typically contracts with an intermediary of sorts, like social finance, to go out and find the best solution, the best intervention to solve that social challenge that the state government is trying to address. So in that process, and you know, lots of people are, Karen and Scott, involved in venture capital, we use the traditional due diligence tools, if you will, from the private kind of for-profit sector to think about, has this intervention been proven to work? What is the management capacity of this management team? Can they actually scale and deploy the capital responsibly? Do they have the right governance structure to ensure sustainability and longevity to this structure? And after kind of sifting through a bunch of providers, a bunch of interventions, talking to lots of people, we then work with government to construct a pay-for-success contract with the provider or a set of providers in mind in an arrangement that basically articulates that government only pays upon success according to these metrics, and if the program does not achieve those metrics, then the investors that we recruit to front these interventions stand to lose part of their principal. So it's a win-win-win arrangement, and the financial engine that drives this win-win-win, because it's ultimately not a grant, people expect their money back, is the whole concept of having a mechanism to monetize prevention. Where can you invest a dollar of prevention today to save many more dollars of basically treating the problem downstream? And we're seeing really interesting applications around recidivism, early childhood applications, management of chronic illnesses, aging solutions, et cetera. And it's really exciting, yet it's, and I know you'll get to this in your second round of questions, yeah. David, it's barely been 3 years that the world's first social impact bond was launched in the UK. We do not have a proof of concept. We're all learning rapidly. But that said, there's just tremendous excitement around the world. In fact, Karen and I were in London together in June, where David Cameron, as the host country for the G8 presidency, hosted a day-long convening on these issues. And at the heels of that day-long convening, there's now a G8 social investing task force that's being formed, chaired by Sir Ronald Cohen, that involves the G8 countries, plus Australia, plus the EU. So 10 jurisdictions, 2 delegates from each jurisdiction, 20 people, and had actually a 2-day convening on September 30th and October 1st. Very interesting dinner on the night of September 30th, sitting with the Italians and the Germans and what have you. We're not going to work tomorrow, right? Some of the USG people. Anyway, so this task force is being formed, and then each nation is forming its own advisory board to really tackle these very timely questions in a fiscally resource-constrained environment.
Great, thanks. So tons of attention to social impact bonds, sort of overloading this super dynamic field, but also untested field, and it's very exciting intellectually to study. It seems a little crazy to be involved in, frankly. it's just the complexity that Tracy deals with is really impressive and intimidating. Dave.
Great.
And if you could speak about your new role, but also a little bit about your old role.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thanks. Well, thanks, David. I'm honored to be here at the IOP with Tracy, Karen, and Scott, real leaders in this field. And I think we've got great representation of the different elements of the impact economy, which is a real priority for the president. And I think when thinking about the impact economy, it's important to note and be aware that it exists in the context of the broader economy. And we think about when the president, around the time the president came in office, we were in the middle of a major financial meltdown. Household net wealth fell by about $16 trillion as a result of the financial crisis. Since the president has come into the office and the economy has turned around, we've rebuilt about $15 trillion in household net wealth. 7.6 million private sector jobs have been created in the last 43 months. 500,000 of those are manufacturing jobs, which is the fastest growth in 15 years. A lot of the work that the SBA did is and the Obama administration is what made that possible under Karen. And GDP is at an all-time high. But we also know that the impacts fell disproportionately on vulnerable communities. And the president cares deeply about those communities, and he's advanced innovative solutions to move the dial on that front. And one of those solutions was a new office he created within the White House called the White House Office of Social Innovation and Civic Participation, which is where I work. So the goal of the White House Office of Social Innovation is to enhance the impact of social enterprise, of the social sector, and increase its effectiveness to strengthen communities, to increase job creation, and to support economic recovery. We do that in 3 ways: by enhancing human capital, financial resources, and driving evidence-based policy. My portfolio is the social finance and evidence-based policy portion of our work there at the Office of Social Innovation. And so what that means more specifically is working on policies that enhance and create a more enabling environment for finance and to encourage the entrance of capital markets using subsidy to bring in capital markets to enhance the social sector, which is nonprofit organizations and social enterprises. That's everything. That's the world of social impact investing, from the CDFI world, community development financial institutions, impact investing by individual, high net worth individuals and others, and philanthropic investing. On the evidence-based policy side, I work in the areas where evidence and data-driven solutions intersect with finance. So I'm the senior policy officer at the White House working on pay for success, social impact bonds, and also working on innovation funds. There are three innovation funds in the government, the federal government, the Department of Labor, the Department of Education, and the Corporation for National Services Social Innovation Fund, which has a terrific leader in Michael Smith. We are focused on ways to enhance the effectiveness of the sector, drive evidence. If one solution is 30% more effective than another, and we've got the evidence to show it, well, we can encourage driving resources in that direction in a way that makes a real difference for vulnerable communities, for families, and strengthen our economy and communities in that way. In the past, I've worked for about 10 years in the CDFI sector. CDFI stands for Community Development Financial Institution, and the Treasury Department certifies CDFIs nationwide, organizations that invest financial resources into communities in needs all around the country. So there are about 1,000 CDFIs. It's a sector that has about $64 billion in assets and invests about $6 billion a year in small business and affordable housing, churches, charter schools, and a number of various community investing areas. So I helped to start first a bank in New Haven, Connecticut. It's called Start Bank, one of three banks, I think, to get a charter the year that it got its charter a few years ago, which is a CDFI there. And for the last 7.5 years, I've been working, before coming to the White House, as the executive director of City First Enterprises, which is a federally regulated bank holding company of a CDFI bank and a family of CDFIs. About $300 million in assets, one of the leading banks, CDFI banks in the country for achieving mission impact, according to NCIF. And
they don't know who NCIF is, but
right.
It's good.
It's good. They know what they're talking about. National Community Investment Fund. And so there I was able to work blending public capital and private capital to close deals across sectors. We started an affordable housing nonprofit that won a Social Innovation Fund award. And we started a venture fund to encourage smaller foundations to do investing in underserved communities. And worked a lot on anchor strategies to have large institutions like universities and hospitals source more of their procurement in the local community, localize their supply chain, and be intentional about the businesses that they work with, working with more small businesses, and working quite a bit on crowdfunding, and in particular, securities crowdfunding.
Great. I met with a colleague of Dave's on Monday who was up here visiting and talked about crowdfunding. And just totally fast, just heads up for the questions. If you want to know about crowdfunding, ask him. They've done a lot. Karen, you, as I said at the beginning, we out in the field were so excited by the work that went on at SBA because here was something that was happening and money was moving, and especially exciting about it was that the SBA was pairing up with the market rate side and with pension funds and not just with the foundation community. And part of the puzzle here is to try to bring all these things together to create impact. So if you could tell us how you see the field now that you're out in the world.
Well, I'm delighted to be here. And I know that there's tremendous interest at the Kennedy School and also at the business school here at Harvard in this. How many of you are also taking some kind of business course, some kind of structured finance course? Well, you should, because what we are talking about here is a really exciting confluence. And in some ways, it matches, you know, sort of the pieces of my life coming together. But we are marrying financial structuring with solving some gaps that the market can't solve alone. So government or other forces have to step in and solve major problems facing our society and our world. And what's exciting about it is, you know, we were all pretty smart about creating derivatives and other things in the financial world. Why can't we be smart about this? Turns out we can. I spent most of my career in the private sector. I was a venture capitalist for 25 years. And about 5 years ago, I had the great honor of going to work in public service for this president. And I was head of the Small Business Administration and also a member of his cabinet and part of his economic team, the National Economic Council. And as David said, when we came in, I came in as one of the early appointees in December 2008, the world was a mess. And it was particularly a mess for small businesses and for underserved populations. And as you know, we jumped in, we're able to do some things at the SBA to unlock credit for small business. We raised our guarantees to 90%. We reduced our fees. We flooded billions of dollars out into what turned out to be very, very good credits and got small businesses going. What we found is that there was uneven recovery and there were still gaps. And in fact, there were a number of sectors where capital was not getting to small businesses and entrepreneurs for a whole variety of reasons. So as part of Startup America, as part of impact investing, and as part of this focus that we had, the president had, and we had across the economic team of solving market gaps, reaching in and helping our economy grow and create jobs by figuring out where there wasn't access to capital, for instance, we looked under the hood at the SBA and say, we're not going to be able to get a new program for $1 billion through Congress right now. This was true even in 2010. And so we said, what are we going to do? And we have at the SBA a program called Small Business Investment Company. And we had the ability to put out $3 billion a year as a limited partner, supporting in public-private partnerships. And we had about 300 sort of mini venture funds all around the country. But we were using only a very small part of that $3 billion every year. We're using about $600 million. Why? Thing was a mess. It was very bureaucratic. It took 15 months to get a license. So Sean Green, who ran that for me, fixed that. Took him a couple years. And then we looked up around the beginning of 2011. We were looking for vehicles to make an impact, to solve this gap. And we said, we can take this program, this SBIC program, without any additional congressional authority or money, and take a sector, a segment of it. We took $1 billion of it over 5 years, $200 million a year, and devoted that to what we call impact SBICs. How do they work? Well, if you're an outside general partner, venture capitalist, who has a track record of wanting to put money into growing companies, and we will, at the SBA, match every dollar 2-to-1. You raise $50 million, we would put a $100 million debenture against it. Now you have $150 million. And this would go into segments of the country where venture capital wasn't going. 70% of the venture capital in this country goes to three states. Goes to California, Massachusetts, we're fortunate, and New York. And what about the rest of the country? Well, there are entrepreneurs out there that we need to be growing and creating jobs. So the first impact fund that we licensed was in Michigan. Well, in 2011 in Michigan, we were barely seeing the light after the auto bailout. It wasn't entirely clear that Michigan was going to survive at all. And there were terrific small businesses there that couldn't get growth capital, mm-hmm. particularly some of the automotive supply companies were transforming themselves, enormous prospects, and nobody would invest in Michigan. So we brought in the private sector, we brought in Dow Chemical, we brought in the Michigan Investment Fund, And we brought in a general partner who was experienced. It was Credit Suisse First Boston, who had a, and we created Invest Michigan. And that was the first impact SBIC. And the second was is in North Carolina around energy. We picked three segments, a geography that's underserved by the markets that can't get capital, a set of people, so it could be women-owned businesses, it could be underserved market, it could be low-income areas, and the third is a sector. So it could be green energy, it could be a sector where you can make an impact. Another one that's quite interesting is educational tools. Now, this is all very much on the return on capital, an equivalent return on capital that you would expect from a non-impact fund. In fact, some people say, how do you tell the difference? And it's a good question. But it is, if you think of the social impact investing that we're talking about here, there's a continuum from the social impact bonds, which the return is in money, but it's also in what you're really looking for is the social outcome. And here, it's financial engineering to solve problems that the market is not solving. So it's creating access to capital in places in this country, and it can be used, the structure can be used in many forms. And the final thing is the cost to the government in the budget line of the SBA is zero. Why is it zero? Because it turns out that these investments pay back the debentures. The debentures are the first money. If they have a loss, it goes to the investors. Zero. So here we've got kind of, you know, a perfect vehicle. And this year we're going to do at the SBA, instead of $600 million, we're going to do the full $3 billion worth of allocations. And in the next budget, we asked for $4 billion. And I think Congress is inclined to do that because, once again, the net cost is zero.
Great. Thanks a ton. And I would say, I mean, the demonstration effects of having this project out there and the ability of the SBA to create data for, you know, Dave's data-driven analysis is another hugely important piece of this, because the theory is the market's not there because of information asymmetry or some other sort of cultural constraint, and the SBA can help make markets where they aren't existing otherwise. Scott, you have like one of the, you were head of one of the most recognizable enterprises that people would think have a, has a social purpose and
sometimes
a financial
over-recognized
return.
For things that I don't,
well,
I
you get to parking spaces everywhere, so we see them. What does it look like from the end of the enterprise itself that should be getting the impact investing dollars presumably out there?
You asked us to sort of describe what part of the spectrum we're in. I'm in the one head to pat, one ass to kick end of it, I guess, is the way it works because we have a P&L in the company. So just a quick history. I joined the company about 10 and almost 11 years ago now. It was a big idea, small company based here in Cambridge, with literally about 1,000, 2,000 people using the service. Today, it's about a $300 million revenue business with about 1 million people using the car. So in 10 years, it was a lot of fun to build that. The story that is now, I think, being told unfolded over 10 years, and it's really a pretty interesting on reflection now. I left the company after selling it about 6 months ago, so I went from being a public company CEO to a investor. My candor level is going up a lot, and so I'm able to tell the story a little more with more candor now. I think the two things that I would want to sort of impart on you is about our business have to do with talent or team on one end and then metrics on the other end, because I think both of those apply to almost wherever you are in the spectrum here. And we just heard a little bit about Karen's use of data and metrics to sort of prove the points that she was getting at. And that was a real lesson for us inside Zipcar. So let me start there. When we talk about Zipcar, whether it was a brand or a company that was an employer that you could work in, or a partner with a city where we were trying to get parking spaces, or an insurance company that was going to underwrite our drivers, the purposeful part of the business was always a part of the conversation. I felt that was important, that if you didn't understand the impact that we were going to have as a company, you probably weren't going to be a very good employee, a very good investor, a very good partner, a very good manager in the company. If you didn't feel that personal connection to that, and some would call that mission, I would call it purpose. That's sort of the way I come at it. We were a company with a purpose. We had a soul in the company. I think we do today. And the challenge with that is it can sort of get overplayed when you're small. And I used to say to our employees, we have to get much bigger before we can really take that purpose and do something with it. Mm-hmm. So let's just get out there and make a big company. In fact, when I took the job, the guy that ran the search committee, I wasn't the founder, but I came in sort of in the second year of the company. It was in a real troubled state. The guy that ran the search committee is a very prominent angel investor, an investor here in town. I'm not going to say his name. But I stopped by his house to sign the employment contract, and he gave me this great bottle of French wine. And he said, I want you to go turn this political movement into a big company. And I had done a really short due diligence project on this because I was just really fascinated by the company. I remember backing out of the driveway thinking, turn a political movement into a big company. Did I miss something here? And it already, so the point is, back in those days, the company really had a mission at its core. It was probably going at it a little too hard at the mission and not enough on the metric side of it. So what we tried to do was really understand what vocabulary and what metrics could we articulate that would describe the success of the mission that we were after. So we started measuring and doing surveys and asking people, when you use Zipcar, how likely or how often are you as a group selling cars or not buying cars when you use our service? And the ratio continued to be about 15 cars came off the highway for every car we put on because people were selling cars or not buying cars when they were using our service. That 15-to-1 ratio is a powerful statement. Mm-hmm. So what can you do with that? You can walk into a mayor's office or somebody who runs parking in a city and say, I'm going to reduce dramatically the amount of parking you need in the city if you let me get big around you. Just by virtue of me getting big, you're going to need less parking in the city. And there's very few companies that kind of come at it that way. And I think so that the metrics and being able to articulate metrics that both talk about your mission and the solution or the purpose or the impact that you can have, but also have a real business impact on somebody else's challenge or problem becomes very important. The other thing that we started to look at was, well, we think people save a lot of money when they use our service because they're not owning cars anymore. They're not spending as much money on cars that sit around. The first data point that I found interesting is about 90%+ of the time, cars in cities sit around idle, more than 90% of the time. Well, you must be able to reduce, you've got to be able to reduce that idle time if you use shared services. Just by, you know, multiple people accessing the same car, that should go up. Well, our typical utilization rate was more like 55 or 60% across the whole week. So as that 15-to-1 ratio kicked in, utilization rates also went up. And what happened in return was, people were saving a lot of money, and they started to tell us, we probably save about $300 a month, $400 a month after we pay our access to Zipcar. So if you multiply that by all the members that we had out there, literally $100 million or so was flowing back into the economy because people weren't paying car payments and insurance payments and parking payments and repair bills for cars that were sitting around 95% of the time. That's a social good. If you really do the math there, that money goes back into local restaurants. It pays off school loans in many cases. It buys the first flat. It does something to support, or God forbid, it goes into savings and they save something. So that's what was happening in the background. So we started talking about it and we measured it. The U.S. Census will tell you that about 19% of U.S. household income goes into transportation on average across the country, 19%. In the Zipcar household, it's about 5%. So that delta is a huge amount of money that is being used on all those things I just talked about. That's a huge social good. Did we really have that nailed at the beginning? No, but the more time we spent on how to articulate those two simple points, 19% goes to 5%, and every car we put on takes away 15 personal cars, that resonates with almost everybody that we talk to. So metrics are a really important part of wherever you are in this spectrum. Our way to have a dialogue about social impact. And I think that helps solve some of the ratio problem you described, the more hard metrics we can get out there, and our Parthenon training would get at it. And the other thing I wanted to mention was team. The difference almost always between success and failure in anywhere in the spectrum is team. Can you attract the best and brightest and retain them for long periods of time to do what you're trying to do. And I will tell you that if you narrow this down to particularly to the millennials, but almost anybody at Zipcar that worked for the company or worked for the company today, they feel a strong connection to the purpose of the company. And they feel that strong connection because they like the 15-to-1 ratio story. They love the idea that we're helping people save money and we're making cities better places to live. So yes, of course they like getting a paycheck and they love getting benefits and they love stock options when we gave them out. But if you really peeled it back and asked them to be honest with us about why are you here and why are you staying here, they would articulate one of those other things. It was almost never how much I get paid, you know, or my stock options or some of the, which we hear a lot about in for-profit high-growth companies that are venture capital backed. And so I think the real message in there is purpose-driven companies that have real mission at the core can attract and retain the best and brightest better than anybody, and I would say particularly millennials. Millennials under age 30 or 35, wherever you want to put the breakpoint, are more attracted to the notion of a purpose-driven, mission-driven enterprise, whether it's for-profit or non-profit, than any generation that's preceded them. There's lots of data out there that says this now. So the more important point of this is get that mission out there if you're in a business like Zipcar. And there's a company, I looked at a couple other examples I wanted to mention, Warby Parker. Anybody here know who they are? They make eyeglasses. Well, eyeglasses are very high priced. They're trying to disrupt the distribution side of the eyeglass market. But if you look at what their core purpose is, it says everybody has a right to see. That's a big statement. And if you buy Warby Parker glasses, you can make a contribution while you're buying the glasses to buy eyewear for somebody in Africa. And it's a very small addition to what you do. And they ship that, and they ship the eyeglasses and make sure that somebody in Africa is going to have eyeglasses. They have a right to see too. They're making eyeglasses. It's a pretty mundane product, right? But they've turned their product and their mission into something that I think is pretty compelling. And there are a lot of companies that are starting to think through this through a very different lens and build the brand, the consumer brand, the employee brand, around something that's much more purpose-driven than Ray-Ban or Sunglass Hut ever did, if you're in that sector. So I think that's exciting for companies of the future, and it's something that we should all be thinking about, because it's not just the right thing to do, it's the right way to run a business to attract the most talented and retain the most talented people. In the world I see today. And so I've left Zipcar. I'm now looking at new investments kind of on my own. I may join an investment firm to do this. And I'm going to keep looking at it. So I joined the board of a company called Coach Up here in Boston, helping to match coaches with kids who need coaching help. And that's a for-profit company, and they're doing great. Just raised $6.5 million on Tuesday. We announced hard-charging venture capital guys coming into this deal. Very purpose-driven company. Big marketplace, and I think they're going to be very disruptive. So exciting to see how new companies can come along and take some of the ideas that Zipcar started and now fan those out into other categories and keep building new companies.
That's great. So I totally buy the sort of employment aspects of this, right? I mean, the team building aspects of the purpose-driven company are very convincing, and there is research. I'm also fascinated by the bookends here. The calculation you're making on Zipcar there for its social benefit is not all that different from what Tracy's making right to government on the social impact bond. I see that we are moving on into the question section. I had more questions myself and prefer the sound of my own voice. but apparently the sounds of your voice are what we're going to hear. I do want to ask, if you all can line up, and we're going to do one quick little round here, and then I'll give you your instructions for your questions. I have three things that you need to know before you say anything. But I do, given what we've just heard, just briefly, what's one thing that you would change in order to make this market grow? If you could say that pop, 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 Dave.
One thing that I would change?
Yes.
I would make it easier for individuals to invest across income levels in the impact economy.
Mm-hmm. The retail market is what's untapped.
That's right.
Great. Tracy.
And the demand is there. The supply is there if we could make it easier.
Uh-huh.
Encourage governments to experiment so that we can see more proof points in the market, because the hype needs to catch up with the hype.
Yep. Yeah. And the data coming out of all of you all's presentations is very clear. Scott.
I would just follow on my earlier comments. I think if you were to sort of rethink this problem and just look at the like marketers do, the segment that strikes me as most attracted to this right now are the millennials, and really rethink and look through that lens. Not that I would give up on the rest of the population, but I think if you really think about how to solve this problem through the lens millennials think through, that's a pretty interesting exercise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, don't give up on me, though.
I'm not giving up.
I'm there, too, right?
But we're followers. Millennials are leading on this, so.
Karen.
I think you need innovation in each of the three sectors. So we need better financial constructs and to optimize those. And I think we'll be able to get there. I think we need more success stories, so more, mm-hmm. more product, more governments. As Tracy said, I led the U.S. delegation, the G8 delegation, and the U.K. is way ahead of us, way ahead of us. We are behind. So that's okay. Maybe they'll do some successes and we'll copy them. But I think the key on the investor side is we need institutional money. Yes. And there are some proposals before Treasury and the policy side which would allow purposeful investment of endowments in a very narrow way. And so this is not necessarily, you know, a university endowment, but if you're a Rockefeller Foundation and you want to do, or if you're the state of Michigan and you want to take a piece of your pension fund, and you can, you know, manage the risk side of this, can you put that money in a place that also is mission-driven? And there's a lot of controversy about this and how much of this, but there probably is some narrow piece of it that could unlock enough dollars for the purposes with some financial oversight.
Yeah.
So that's something I think that's worth looking at, although it's not a slam dunk.
Yeah, I think that's hugely important, but it is a field that's going to be very, it's a tough nut to crack. Yeah. Great, thank you all so much. We're going to go to questions now. There are rules, which I'm going to read to you, so you have all of them. There are three. One has an exclamation point. all questioners must identify themselves. That's just, you know, no exclamation. One brief question per person. Don't make any speeches, those of you with the microphone. And the questions end with a question mark. That ended with an exclamation point. I was fascinated by that. So we'll start over here on the left.
Hi, my name is Caroline. I'm a junior at the college, and I'm asking this question on behalf of the forum committee. As was alluded to earlier tonight, a lot of venture firms and entities that focus on driving social change operate almost exclusively in cities and urban areas. What potential do you see for those services to expand to rural communities, and how can we better connect would-be entrepreneurs with people who are willing to fund their ideas?
So I'll start with that. Tom Vilsack, who was a fellow here at the IOP and is a great member of this community, has been a great partner in terms of focusing on rural communities and making sure, I don't know if there's a cabinet meeting where he didn't say, now, how are we going to have a rural aspect of this policy? So there is, when you travel across this country, you can be in Iowa and you can find a high-tech venture that is well worth investing in. So one of the things that we did with this same SBIC program is do a similar carve-out and commitment to rural communities. And we track how much money goes into rural communities through the SBIC program. It is definitely, and I encouraged all my venture capital friends to go start looking in other parts of the country. You know, look in Nashville, look in Utah, look in Arkansas. Look in Alabama, there are companies and entrepreneurs, and instead of just following the herd, you need to get out there. So there's some mechanisms for both the social enterprise and also the regular venture capital money. One's called accelerators, and one of the things that we worked on there that I'm going to continue to work on the business school, is to get more accelerators, places where startups can convene in parts of the country that don't currently have those kind of ecosystems, and to build those.
Mm-hmm. I'd add that rural communities is something that the president has prioritized, and I can think of a couple. I could go on for a while, but So a couple of items that I think are particularly salient in this context, which is the CDFI Fund's New Markets Tax Credit Program, which is a multi-billion dollar program to incentivize investing in underserved communities, has, during the president's administration, created a special set-aside for rural communities to encourage investment in those communities. In addition, the president in June announced his climate action plan and has now created his state and local task force, which includes representatives from rural areas. A big focus on rural communities is resiliency in the face of climate change. And the president's climate action plan will focus significantly on driving innovation and investment in areas that could be subject to drought and other agricultural challenges that we may face as a result of climate change. So there's a big focus there, and it's going to be those entrepreneurs getting investment to them who are tackling and challenging and solving these challenges.
I think the two things I would add is crowdfunding and the ability to use crowdfunding now is probably going to, over time, help this because it's going to be able to create more of a marketplace for people in rural and other areas to get their message and their business plan out to funders that would never otherwise see it. And if they're, I think that's, you know, that's the wonder of the internet is just that you can connect with people all over the world that have a similar belief
in
you.
Technology is.
I think that's one of the big solutions.
Going to be a positive in this whole.
And I've also, community. The other one I was going to mention, I've heard about a couple of experiments, which I'm actually attracted to, and I'm going to dig into this some more now that I have some time, is some of the rural high schools. I personally think that, I grew up in a rural high school in Pennsylvania. There was no focus on entrepreneurship in my high school. I mean, I got lucky and got into entrepreneurship. I think high schools could be really interesting sort of starting points for people who are almost socialized. If you're in farmland Iowa, you're probably almost socialized into thinking, I probably can't be an entrepreneur, I shouldn't be an entrepreneur because there's no money here and there aren't other, whatever. And I think high schools could be a place where you could have labs of innovation within the high school and start to take away that socialization, especially in rural America, where anybody, because of the internet, because of crowdsourcing, because you can start a business on the internet with almost no money today if you know how to use a little bit of technology and branding. I think everybody can be an entrepreneur. And that message isn't really out there, particularly if you're outside of a major city. And if you don't go to a major university where there's a big entrepreneurship setting within the university. So high schools are probably an extension of that idea. I don't know how quite to take that idea forward, but I think it's a place that we should look harder at.
Yeah, I would just add, we've been doing a lot on place-based impact investment. And this is a place where cross-sector partnerships in the rural communities can really make a difference. And there are, you know, worlds of community foundations who could be partners and who could be places for incubators and who could be places to match up different kinds of investment who haven't really sort of entered into this discussion. And they're just starting to. I think there's definitely changes going on in rural areas. Thank you.
Thank you.
Over here.
Hi, my name is Theo Sebastian, and I'm a 1L at Harvard Law School. So Harvard Law students are also extremely interested in this whole area of social innovation. It's not just business school and K school. So my question...
I'm a lawyer too, sadly.
Yes, I actually just saw that on your bio. You went to the other law school, but I'll forgive you.
Apologies.
All right.
There's only two?
So Tracy, I really enjoyed hearing your insight into social impact bonds. And stemming from that, I am extremely interested in the architecture of this emerging social economy. And by architecture, I mean things like a social stock exchange, an ability maybe to trade the sort of bonds that you're talking about to raise even more revenue.
This is one of those where we need a question mark.
Yes. Okay. And so my question is, what do you see down the pipeline in terms of this social architecture, and where do you think there's room for legal research?
Excellent question. And by the way, the dean at the law school is a fantastic enthusiast of this innovation, and her commitment to public service is wonderful. So wonderful that the law school is represented here. The larger ecosystem is a topic that those of us in this small world of paper success thinks constantly about. If you think about why there's only been two or three experiments in the United States, over a dozen in the UK, two in Australia, despite the interest and the hype, It's because there is no central framework for different participants to speak in the same language, to think about risk assessment, to think about contracting. If you think about all the touch points that this financing interacts with, you have to deal with tax accountants, you have to deal with lawyers around procurement, you have to think about the capital markets piece of it. You have to think about the social service and social scientists. How do you think about evidence, articulation of metrics? Does the administrative data exist? And there's no, you know, kind of templatized way to think about the world, but that's not a bad thing. We are building a brand new field, and early standardization could be unhelpful. I think we need to continually to learn. What we experience around a recidivism project might have very different characteristics from a health project. What we do in red states could be very different from the contracting procedures in a blue state. What we do at a federal level versus at a local and a state level could be very different. And that's why I keep going back to the fact that we need proof points, we need more experimentation, and we need the courage of folks to take the risk to do it. And the federal government, you know, to give a plug to what Dave's office and Jonathan Greenblatt has been just fantastic at, is the articulation of this incentive fund, $300 million that the president proposed in his 2014 budget, which would be run out of Treasury, to think about correcting for some of those market failures and inefficiencies that Karen spoke so eloquently about. How do you provide credit enhancement so that the risk is lower, or the perceived risk is lower by the investor? How do you think about using that pot of money to correct for vertical silos at the federal and state level, or the horizontal silos across agencies? So we need a lot of experimentation, and we are waiting with bated breath whether it could pass. I have my views on that, but, and Dean David Elwood actually said this quite eloquently. You know, David said, while we're seeing quite a bit of gridlock in Washington, the level of innovation and the desire to experiment at the state and local level is extraordinary, and this is what we're experiencing.
But I do think that we have to get some realism, and this, and we have to up the action to talk piece of this. So you can talk about a nice, a place we're gonna trade these things. We have to have a few more. Then two,
yes,
to trade. So focus on what an outcome that's actually achievable. And this is something I think I really need to urge practitioners, if you're going to be serious here, that you can get so engaged in the social good that you're going to do that you forget that you actually have to deliver, you know, some kind of product that works. And if we are going to do this, we've got to get going.
And Karen, to that point, I would note that there's maybe nowhere in the country that's doing more to build that market than the activity right here in Boston.
Yes.
Between Tracy's work, yep, and Harvard's SIB Lab. I see Sebastian in the back, who I got to meet with earlier today. Harvard really is seeding and building capacity in states, red and blue, across the country to implement this preventive solution to save resources and have better impacts. And
so I'm just going to say one more thing. I think 2014 is going to be a pivotal year for social impact bonds. The activity that Sebastian, Jeff Liebman, and others are doing around the country is really trying to, you know, remove the obstacle around the deal flow problem. Because a lot of people ask me about why, you know, the hype is far ahead of reality. Is it a deal flow problem, a product problem, or is it a capital problem? I keep saying it's a product problem because it takes a long time to incubate and get these projects up to speed. Investors are ready. Now, you know, these are still socially minded investors, but there's capital waiting to be deployed.
Yeah, no, your infrastructure question is the perfect one. Because we don't have this sort of intermediation function is new, it's untested. There's a lot of legal work to be done, I think, at this level for the experimentation on the social impact things, but also for what Karen was talking about. I mean, the ERISA questions around bringing in institutional capital into this space are real, and we need more attention to them. Over here.
Hello. Sorry, I got to lower this a little bit. Thank you for coming tonight. I actually wanted to push all of you on the topic of metrics.
Introduce yourself.
Sorry, my name is Yanina Wolf. I'm not a student here. And I know we've tossed around metrics.
Thanks for coming.
Yay. Zipcar has mentioned kind of how they calculate the 15 to 1. So what I wanted to know is, how do you measure your impact? Are you using gears, iris? Is there a specific way that you're actually looking at that you are making an impact, and then you're using that to prove it forward?
Mm-hmm. Scott, you want to start with Zipcar?
Well, we talked about the metrics that we use within the company. There's also results that came out of that I didn't talk about on the policy side. Rental car taxes, for example, were really invented to tax people that land in an airport, pick up a car, and go back to the airport and drop it back off again. And they were thought up and enacted before Zipcar was ever even around. So we sort of got caught up in that. And so for people that live in cities that were using Zipcar, they started getting caught up in the web of rental car taxes that were out there. So we used metrics like the ones I talked about and others to start to change policy and say, look, if people are behaving exactly the way policymakers are asking us to behave, getting rid of cars, living more sustainably, living through smart economic means in their personal household and how they spend their money, why are we taxing them to behave that way? It seems silly. So we took those taxes away, and not quite a few cities that had it. Parking spaces. So metrics were the part of the dialogue that, you know, that was an important part. Parking was another one in our case where we were willing to pay market price for curbside parking if we could just work with the city. The problem is cities and governments don't work very well with for-profit companies unless there's a long history of doing it, right? There's got to be a long path to do that. So we had to use metrics to really prove what would happen if they allocated some of the curbside space to Zipcar and let us park our cars there. And we were paying market rates. It wasn't an economic question. It was, could we even do it at all? So that was the result of hard work on metrics and analysis that we did.
Did you see much demand out there in the world for the social metrics? I mean, you have such a good, strong account of them, but were there people asking for them?
I think we weave them in. I mean, I think part of the problem that we're hearing about today is, to me, it's not an either or. I think this idea of purpose-driven companies in particular I think it ought to be mainstream. I mean, it really is the way a lot of people are thinking. We're solving some of the biggest, or facing some of the biggest problems, you know, around the environment, around economic impact in cities that we've ever faced. So the world's ready to hear these stories. Mm-hmm. I think often they come across as do good. And you have to do well and do good as a company together and sort of marry those metrics. And I think that's an important, and that idea of getting big. I mean, one of our core values was deliver results. Yeah. Another one was have an impact. So we had both of them covered in our company. And I think it's really important for any institution or enterprise that's focused in this space to understand delivering results through scorecards and metrics is really important. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're never going to get to have the impact that you really aspire to have.
So our major impact is job creation. That's the number I look at first. And to get there, the first thing you look at is capital deployed. So you want to deploy this kind of capital, you know there's a gap. And you look at how much money actually gets into the hands of companies, how many companies add employees. And those were the big metrics. And we were able to track it pretty closely. And use these dashboards.
I just make the quick point that it's notable to think about something that's important, which is not how you measure, but what you measure. There's a number of federal and state programs that measure outputs rather than outcomes. So think of a homelessness support organization. Their standard for funding is how many beds they may have. Rather than how many people whose lives they're able to help stabilize and become independent. Mm. And so I think we are seeing people have been talking about this for a while, but I think we're seeing increasing movement at the federal government and state government level to be more oriented towards outcomes, mm-hmm. Measurable outcomes, rather than just simple formulas that might simply contribute to the status quo.
And from the City First perspective, so our technocratic friends in the foundation community who want metrics for social impact, you were at the core of that probably. Did you have a method? Did you find a set of metrics better? Do you think standardized metrics is vital for the field?
I think standardized metrics would be very helpful. Most of the people who work in the field aren't on the finance side, and they're not on the foundation side. They're on the service delivery side. They're out there in the trenches doing the job. And when you've got 17 different funders and they each ask you for their own independent, internally developed and not discussed among each other series of metrics, then you're spending way too much time answering questions rather than serving the people you're supposed to be serving. So yes, standardized metrics would be valuable. And one thing we do at the Office of Social Innovation is encourage foundations to adopt standardized metrics across a number of different areas.
Yeah, and simple rules of thumb like SBA used are a way to get
absolutely
real metrics. Tracy, you want to answer this one?
I don't have a lot more to add, but just that each field will have metrics specifically meaningful to that field. So community development metrics would look very different from, say, what would be important for the SBA, would look very different from, say, publicly traded large corporations. You know, there's, for example, another movement that Bob Eccles over at the business school is leading, which is around creating a SASB, you know, as opposed to FASB, a sustainable accountable board. And that would affect so many publicly traded companies, and that could have also significant impact. So while it would be wonderful to aspire to harmonizing all metrics, it's simply social problems are complex and multidimensional. Right. It's very difficult to do so.
Some things are incommensurable, mm-hmm. And that's okay.
Yeah. My name is Josh Ramacher. I actually work for Credit Suisse in the area of structured finance. I've been doing it for about 10 years, and I just recently kind of found out about social impact investing. And to your point about finding institutional investors and about the working within the confines of an investment bank, I've recently kind of made the decision to leave that portion of the investment banking world and hopefully go into social impact investing. My question would be, is it, I guess, beneficial to the overall movement to hypothetically work within the confines of an investment bank and be paired with institutional investors and, I guess, the creativity of the finance within that confine, or to come over to, the social impact investing arena and work through that way. Uh-huh. So I know that confluence between investment banks and social investing will probably be very beneficial.
So career advice on which path to follow.
How can I help the most?
What's going to bring in the money most effectively?
Oh, I think absolutely. This is going to work when large institutions like investment banks see a benefit in it. And I'm a big believer that we have that potential. We're not at that point. So for instance, we've had a lot of talk about an infrastructure bank. Mm-hmm. I think there is a model in the SBIC case where you use government guaranteed debentures along with privately raised capital to form an infrastructure bank which would invest in projects that would have a return.
Well, we should talk about that.
you can pretty easily transfer this model, but until and unless a major set of financial players gets to the table in this and in things like the infrastructure bank, it's going to be talk, not, you know, and we're not going to be able to get it done. So I think no matter where you stay in all these pieces, I think that you will find an opportunity as these sorts of deals come down to say, wait a minute, how could we enhance return here by doing a public-private partnership? Mm-hmm. And that sitting at the table with that mentality, you can sit at any one of these tables, a corporate table, you can be in a large corporation as Avis now, you know, is, who took on Zipcar, and say, wait a minute, I see this opportunity, I see it. Meshing with the objectives that I've got in this other institution, and we should do a deal here.
Yeah. I agree with Karen. Yours is a set of skills that could be broadly applicable and useful in a number of areas. I would encourage you to consider spending some time in outside of the investment bank space and in sort of a little more on the ground community investing or sort of social entrepreneur space, because no matter where you end up long term in your career, I think it's incredibly helpful to understand what it's like on the ground and the dynamics there. I will also say that it's an incredibly exciting field to be in because it's still the Wild West, and the people in this room, to the extent they want to work in this sector, I think, have a tremendous opportunity to help shape it and define it and amplify its impact.
Yeah, all kinds of ways in, because it sits in the middle of so many institutions. We have time for one brief, incisive question.
My name is Ben, and I'm a Harvard alum. My question is, there's a history of shareholder activism that's existed with large publicly traded corporations, and sometimes that's ebbed and flowed. And I'm just wondering what you think is a productive outlet for thoughtful shareholder activism and increasing responsible corporate governance. It seems like so many people that own shares oftentimes don't responsibly vote or participate. Mm-hmm. There's certainly large institutions that own shares, but in terms of individual activism and broader movement, what do you think are the prospects for encouraging more social responsibility within larger corporations through that process?
I volunteer you to answer that question. You've been working in this field, David Wood.
I volunteer the panel. Anybody want to respond to the ESG side of things, big, large institutional capital engaging corporations rather than enterprises?
Well, clearly there's a lot of resources there. There's a lot of jobs there. And to the extent investors are actively seeking to influence corporate behavior, there can be a significant impact. It's not the role of the federal government to encourage investors to do that. But I would note something else outside of the world of large corporations is the thousands of small businesses that are popping up all the time. And I think that crowdfunding is a very exciting way in which people are aligning their dollars with their values, and will continue to be able to do that. The president last year put in his State of the Union address the notion of making securities crowdfunding legal in the US. And Congress passed the Jobs Act. SEC will soon have regulations out that will enable everyone to invest in small businesses in their community. And that will include a number of social enterprises. And we're really seeing that growing. Right now, 80% of charitable giving in the United States is provided by individuals. Only 20% is provided by institutions and corporations and foundations. But if you look at charitable investing, mission investing, it's below market return. It's the opposite. The vast majority, if you look at the capital sources of the CDFI sector, it's 80% from institutions, banks and foundations and government, 20% from individuals. And as we remove those barriers and individuals' abilities to invest in their communities, I think we're going to see a lot of influence. Where the money goes is, I think, will be very telling about people's desires to align their values with their dollars.
I think that amplifying some of the case studies, and David, you should chime in here, but there are a lot of mission-driven organizations who actually vote their proxies and are quite active as shareholders. You know, a lot of foundations have strong voices, faith-based groups, unions, pensions, and kind of amplifying those case studies. And I mean, some of them have done remarkable things. You know, Boston Common and others, you know, changing labor practices, you know, influencing environmental practices. And I think, you know, more should be discussed.
Yeah, I mean, well, to end on this and to go back to Karen's point about the spectrum, I have a slightly idiosyncratic take on this, but I don't see any difference between shareholder activism and the social impact bond community in theory. It's all about linking finance and its effects on the world. And that conversation can be had about public equities, it can be had about venture capital, it can be had about innovative new products that are meant to be below market. And I think it's healthy to keep all of those things in mind and then to find, our career advice go, but you know, to find your own path into it. And just keep in mind that there are different ways to have this really fundamental discussion. I really thank the panelists for leading us down many productive paths to do that, and thank you all for coming. And thanks to IOP for hosting. Well 12.